Well, thank you very much for the invitation, Panati. And indeed, last year was a great honor to be at your conference. And it's great to be back with, I hope, even a better story. We learned a lot last year. So I've included a lot of that those learnings in the lesson, in the lecture. On the first slide, I've tried to summarize really the pitch of my story. Data science should have an impact on sustainability because that's what we do it for. But how should that happen? How can that happen? And just to give you a right way, the key of my presentation is that, in my view, data entrepreneurship is the only way to make it happen. Because data doesn't give the right impact only to people. But when we translate data with data entrepreneurship into awareness, into solutions, sustainable solutions and sustainable behavior, then we can have kind of impact. Now, of course, one of the questions you will have at the start already is, what do you say about data science? What is, in your view, data science? Because there are so many definitions out there, I should pick one. And this is the one I use all the time. For me, data science is about finding, validating, and applying insights with data and models to improve decision-making. So for me, data science has only impact when it is translated into decision-making. Then the second question hopefully will be on your side. What is data entrepreneurship? Well, data entrepreneurship for us is finding, evaluating, and exploiting opportunities. Opportunities, that's something which entrepreneurs go for, with data and models to improve customer decisions. So then it is not for yourself, but it is for your customer. Entrepreneurs really apply data and models to make the life of other people better. So I've also made this brief comparison between the data scientists, which many of you will be, and data entrepreneurs, where the data scientist is focused on obtaining insights, data entrepreneurs are focused on building a business driven by data. And a data scientist will collect data, analyze data, and the data entrepreneur will discover or exploit opportunities based on data. Last but not least, a data scientist is focused on really quantitative insights. A data entrepreneur does the same, but is also driven by cases. It's not just insights on data, but also insights on cases. An entrepreneur is comparing cases. He's looking at what others do. He's looking at what governments do. And based on that, he will make decisions. So this is very briefly a summary of the key of my presentation. I don't think I have convinced you all, but just those two slides. So I will build up my story by touching all the three subjects in the middle: awareness, sustainable solutions, and sustainable behavior. What is important for each story you listen to is that the question, why is this person telling this story? And I will briefly summarize for you why I stepped into this storyline. About 6 years ago already, I was writing a small book for the company I was working for, about how we as an optimization company can improve the world. And I hit upon the sustainable development goals, and I found two pictures. One is about the ecological footprint, which is rising all the time, and that was a very bad outlook. And the other picture was about the relationship between footprint and welfare. And I noticed that, as you can see on the second graph, that there are regions with a good welfare, but a very different footprint. As you can see, Norway is about 7 global hectares, which is a measurement of footprint. US is on 10. And many regions are maybe a bit lower on welfare, but far much lower on footprint. I thought, hey, this is strange. So why is it that in the US you need 10 global hectares for a certain welfare, and let's say in Norway you only need 7? So there must be solutions out there which make it possible to move from 10 to 7. And then I started to calculate my own footprint. And that was a big surprise. I was working for an international company, traveling a lot around the world. I was making some great holidays. And my conclusion was that my footprint was even higher than 10 global hectares. And that was for me really a cold shock. I thought, well, if I'm maybe blaming the Americans of living in the wrong way, I'm doing even worse. So let's do something about it. So where the normal benchmark for a footprint is that you spend 25% on food, on housing, on mobility and products and services. And that's about a split which is can be made. So where was I in 2016? Food was not bad. I didn't eat too much beef. Housing was not bad. We have not a huge house and we were doing well on saving heat. But my mobility was really way out of reach. It was killing my total footprint. So in total, I was on 160% of, let's say, the global hectares for Western Europe on average. So I thought, well, I have to do something about it. And so let's focus on this subject and go for it. Together, by the way, with my colleagues who had the same shock. But because I was working in data science and I knew that all the data was out there, I realized the data didn't convince me before. I wasn't aware of it. So something is needed to make it happen for other people. And that's where I hit upon data entrepreneurship. So it should help you from old behavior to new behavior. So briefly, my profile, as Parvati mentioned, I studied at Tilburg and Eindhoven University, then and Indiana. I then joined Philips in the computer business and Digital Equipment, once a well-known computer company number two in the world. Now it's merged with HP. Then I moved into the media world, which was electronic commerce and both broadcasting. And about 14 years ago, I joined Ortec, which is a data science company already at that time. And with all that knowledge of the three different branches, banking, media, logistics, I joined Dietz and I'm now guiding professionals in their career to make to create a new startup for their company. So those professionals, they spend one day a week at the university. And in that time, during a year, they have to create a new startup in data science. Okay, but let's hit the real story with the first focus point, which is awareness. How can data entrepreneurship create awareness for all those people involved in the sustainability goals? Or maybe not involved, but soon to be involved. Well, we know all the goals, and we know that there are a lot of statistics on those goals. And I just picked one out of those, which is the SDG tracker, which is a great source for following how we all do on those goals. So when you go to the SDG tracker, you will find certain goals like poverty, and then you can zoom in on all different statistics with a view per year from 1977, as you see here, to 2017. You can make a chart. You can see all the details behind it. So, how are we doing? Just on a few of those goals. For example, poverty and hunger and life expectancy, we are doing great. It's really, if you see what we managed to do in the last 20 years, 25 years, it seems to be really top of the bill. So that's the good news. This is also coming from a book called Progress from Johan Norberg, who's really who has really a positive look on the global developments. You see that also in the SDG data tracker from on the SDG calls. And by the way, the tracker is backed by our world and data, which I assume many of you will know. And there you can see how different regions are doing. So it's a global development that we are improving on this subject. The same is on the hunger. It's going quite well. However, still, the ecological deficit is growing enormously. So we are doing better, but at a huge price still. And how can you even make that more personal? Well, there is a source of the Global Footprint Network, which summarizes your footprint is built upon. I have here the picture of Germany as an example for Western Europe. And here you see the split in the 25% for each of the parts, in which I summarize goods and services and one component. Now, one of the lessons we learn quickly is that those pie charts, they look very different for different regions. First of all, some of them are much bigger than the others. As mentioned in the start, the United States is about 10, Europe is about 6, and other regions are really much better doing. So like Argentina is only a third of the US. So there are huge differences in this whole world. So we should be aware of that. And we should also take that into account when we think about certain measurements and impacts of measurements. Because it's clear that when something in the US could be changed, could be improved, that has a huge impact for the total figures of all over the world. Here you see a different version of the graph which I used earlier. You see again all the regions, some quite a lot of them at the bottom, which means that they don't have a big footprint. And at the right top side, you see the well-known regions which spend far too much and which are really a problem for the rest of the world. And you see also with the dotted line, what is the world biocapacity, what it is in 2012. And you see it is quite a bit less than the capacity in 1961. And because we are fueling the world, if you can say it like that, the capacity becomes less and less. And that's, of course, a very bad development. I think this picture should be known to many, because this has a huge impact to become motivated for sustainability efforts. Okay. So the bad things are, for example, the material footprint per capita, which is still going up. And one of the things which I noticed in the Western countries is that people say, well, but I have solar panels on my roof and I'm energy neutral. Well, to give you just a thought, the energy we use in the house is only 10 or 11% of our total energy usage, because we should also include energy for mobility, energy for products we buy, energy for services we get, for example, schools, public transport, the whole of the chemical industry. For me personally, I use about 2,000 kilowatt hours a year, but on average in Holland, people use 50,000 kilowatt hours if everything is included. So it's including food, it's including products you buy, it's including services you get. So when people say I'm neutral on energy in my home, which is about 2,000 kilowatt hours, they talk about only 4%. So the very, I shouldn't call it funny, but at least it's remarkable insight that you can become neutral with solar panels on your roof. That's really a bad perception. People are not aware of their total usage. And we can say that in the Western world, the countries I talk about, we are a main part of the problem, because I will hit upon that in a moment. Especially our region should be aware of these things. And in some way, we are just not aware of it. So a big job to go for. So to summarize, there are things going well on certain areas. We are improving, we are doing better on certain things with footprint. But in total, we are doing bad. So That's the same for, well, maybe to pick one of a reason out of it, it's aviation. Maybe aviation as a percentage of total footprint is not increasing, but the total footprint is increasing because everything is increasing. So I think maybe this corona crisis has at least one positive thing, that we learn to live without flying airplanes, but at least less. Another very good point for awareness is the point about the CO2 room we have. This maybe is a complex picture, but I will explain briefly. On the left side, you see the emission, which has been created by people in the period of 1850 till 2000. That's 150 years. That is about 530 gigaton. Then, in the period of 2000 till 2020, we almost did the same, just in 20 years, with the 380 gigaton in that period. Now, the point is that based on the Paris Agreement, if we want to stick below the 1.5 degrees heat increase, we have room, if you can say that, for 500 extra gigaton. If we have put that into our atmosphere, we are done. At least then we will cross the border. Now, there is much more fuel available to even go further than that. So it's very teasing to keep using oil because it is there. But when we talk about the CO2 emission, we hit the limit already. But when we have used 500 gigaton more. And when we take into consideration that we are at this moment have an emissions of 31 gigaton a year, then soon the end is coming closer. And for the Netherlands, I calculated that we have only a room for 60 ton per person for the coming years, and we are using at this moment 10 ton. So in 6 years' time, we in the Netherlands are done with our CO2 reserve. So I think these figures are really an extremely convincing picture of what the job we have to do. And this is all thanks to data science, because without data science, this wouldn't have become clear. On the bad news this morning, this is another bad news picture. That is that 46% of the CO2 emission comes from 10% of the people, which is really a bloody shame, of course. So we know the regions where this problem is coming from. And of course, there is impact coming up from China, but I think that still the biggest impact comes from the Western hemisphere. And one of the things, I think, which is really proving that we could be aware, but we are not aware, is the fact about the combustion engine. Maybe you think, why do you pick that one? Well, there are many millions of combustion engines running around in the world. In Holland, we have, let's say, about 70 million people, and we have about 8 million cars running around. So it's a very good measurement of how we are doing. Now, I cannot ask you all to mention how much the efficiency is of a motor. That's one of the disadvantages of having an online lecture. I will explain to you or tell you the efficiency after 100 years of using combustion engines is 25%. So I always tell the people, you're not driving around in a car, you're driving around in a heater. Because when something creates 75% heat and 25% mobility, you should call it a heater. So we have in Holland 8 million heaters running around and heating the world with such an, a speed. Now, of course, the question is, can we do better? Yes, we can do much better. Racing cars have an efficiency of 50%, but we can't buy a racing car. So we have to do with the 25%. This is really an example of where we can be aware, but we don't have a solution. Well, we have a solution, because as mentioned, the most of the energy is going into the heat. When you have an electric car has an efficiency from electricity to mobility of 90%. Now, of course, the point is that also electricity has to be created. So in the case we make electricity from oil, that's a conversion in the big electricity power plants of 60%. So that's already better than a car, much better. And we use that for driving around, then we still have an efficiency of 36%. So already when moving to electric vehicles, we make a good move. Of course, electricity should be created from sun and wind, at least, or water power. So then we are going into the right direction. But this is just an example of how we can improve by really moving to other solutions. And again, I've asked many people around me, educated people, academic people, do you know the efficiency of a combustion engine? They don't know. And do you know what is the effect of when you move to an electronic vehicle? People don't know. So there, we really need to do something, not just as academics or as SDG people, but also in education. And I will mention it later on. The same is in power of solar. And the funny thing is most people in Holland have about 10 square meters of roof. You can create 2000 kilowatt hours from that, which has a value of about €400. With the same energy, you can spend it in a car. You can drive 10,000 kilometers, which will take you about 500 liters normally, and that will save you €800. So if I use my solar panels just for the car, I can save €800 a year. So in that sense, I say climate is cash. So, okay, so what needs to be solved? There's a great book. I may think maybe most of you know the book, Draw Down, which is indeed the most comprehensive plan on global warming. And there is a list of issues that can be done or measurements that can be taken to really solve the problem. It's a list of 100 points, but already the top seven it has the most impact, can already reduce almost 50% of the footprint. I've added number 13, which is peatlands. That's something we have in Holland, but that's also something which is around in Siberia. And I think one of the biggest disasters coming up is that the peatlands are getting unfrozen. And just to give you a thought, 1 hectare of peatland can have an emission of 40 tons of CO2 each year, because peat is, reacting with oxygen, and it's creating CO2. If it is not frozen and or wet, so if the peatlands are underwater, then they don't do that emission, or when they are frozen. But when they are not frozen and they are not covered by water, then they will do this emission. And I think that will become one of the biggest issues when we have this temperature rise. Okay, so here are the measurements of the effects, as you see, with the percentages. And it's a great list. And as you can see, there are some less known measurements also, which is family planning, which is educating girls, just to make sure that we don't have too many people on this planet. Conclusion of my first part of the story is awareness doesn't change our behavior, because we have known this for a long time, already since the report of the Club of Rome, 1972, Paris Agreement is one of the latest. So how can we make it happen that those figures really make a change? Well, there are some solutions out there, and we are aware, but what is making us doing these, stupid things? Why don't we move quicker to better solutions? And one of the reasons behind this in the psychology, not in the economy, not in the data science, is what is called bounded rationality. When people don't have the right time or information and thinking power, they don't go for the best solution, but they go for the solution they have learned of, they copied from other people. And this bounded rationality is something which is really stopping people from thinking, from acting. And so we have to solve this. And that's really stopping people from thinking about the right objectives, thinking about the right criteria, and thinking about the right alternatives. So what we should do is prevent bounded rationality by better information, better solutions, social patterns, and solve it with data science by when data entrepreneurs build better systems and better recommenders. So when we have data science and data entrepreneurship, we can prevent bounded rationality, or at least decrease it, and make sure that people spend more time on solving this issue and on creating a better world. So this was the first part of my lecture. Based on this, as you say, we should be able to make awareness and also create an attitude in which people say, we have to solve this issue. And again, maybe we as a group together this morning, we are convinced, we are working on it, but there is still such a huge group of people who is not aware and doesn't have the right attitude yet. They have other things to worry about. Of course, COVID, Corona is an issue, but also quite some different issues. And so something should be done. Now about solutions. How are we doing on solutions? I will just list a few of the solutions which give me hope, and which I would like to use as an example of how data science and data entrepreneurship can create better solutions. And I will split them over the four areas, which are food, housing, mobility, and products and services. And as a reference, I've used Western European figures about the impact, but I need to make some reference. So this is just a reference for this presentation. First, a development about food, which is actually coming partly from Holland, which is called hydroponics. Making the right food, or creating it, growing it, and moving it to the right people and consuming it, has a big impact in the world. And one of the solutions which can increase the situation and decrease the footprint of creating food is hydroponics. This is a grow culture based on water, not on soil, which leads to the fact that you can control better the feeding of the plants, and you can prevent a lot of pesticides because you can control the environment much better. Actually, building hydroponics installations, glass houses, has been one of the biggest export products in the Netherlands. Over recent years, many of them have been installed in China and also in America, because people indeed have seen that you can do much better by using these type of installations. Now you can wonder, what is data science doing in this? Well, data science is the finishing touch behind those glass houses, because you can indeed do this based on water. You can do it in a controlled area, but you can even do a better job if you measure everything. So you put sensors in the plants, and you control the temperature and the feeding by very much data-driven installations. And that's actually is also what's happening. So climate control is still there. If the sun is up, yes or no. If there is rain, yes or no, on the outside. Also based on the phase of the growing of the plants, and you can measure how they are doing, and you can control, change the feeds to the plant. So there is a big control room behind these glass houses. Actually, we see that all over the place in farming. So you can talk about a smart farm management system, in which all the things are being measured. They are being put together in a kind of a data warehouse, and from there they are being controlled. And for example, in the picture on the right side, you see a map of fields in the Netherlands, and they have different colors because they are in a different situation. In this situation, it is grass for cows, and they are measuring in this way what the situation of the grass is. If the grass is fit to be harvested and to feed the cows, and by measuring in a better way, they can control it better and farm it in a better way. And actually, this is also happening in fields of potatoes or whatever. And because the soil is not the same everywhere. In Holland, we have gained land from the sea, and that quality of land is different. There can be more sand in it, there can be less sand in it. And depending on that situation, also the things you do with the land will be different. So it can be that you have one field of potatoes, let's say about 100 hectares, and that one third needs some addition of water. Another one third is not necessary, and another one you should get rid of the water. That can happen in Holland, those differences. And it's the same with pesticides. It can be that one area needs a bit of control and the other one doesn't. In the past, we just put the pesticides all over the place because it was not possible to measure all the time where it was needed and what it was not needed. But now with sensors in the place, we can measure it, and we call that precision farming, because then we can put the right stuff on the right spot at the right time. And with this precision farming, there are really huge savings being realized, up to 40%, which is really amazing. And I think that that's really the way to go. And it's a great example of how in the area of food, we can improve a lot, save a lot of pesticides, save a lot of energy, increase quality of food products. Okay, so what type of technology are involved in this smart farming? It's about satellite images, it's about soil survey maps, it's about handheld PDAs, it's about yield monitors. As you can see, the farm really becomes a computer house. On the right top, I have added a small picture of these future farms, just to show you what entrepreneurship can do. Because some people in Holland said, okay, of course, on our earth, we have a lot of sun coming in, and we have the earth to grow plants. But is it possible maybe also to take the sun when the earth is not being used for plants? Just to give you a thought, in Holland we have certain crops that are only on the field for, let's say, 120 days a year. So that means that 240 days there is nothing on the ground. Now, you cannot cover that all with solar panels, because that's not good for the soil, but you can in this case use moving solar panels, which take away a bit of the sun, but also leave the rest for the plants in the ground. So we have now a pilot with moving solar panels, moving over the land, even when the crops is on the land. So we just pick away, take away, let's say 5 or 10% of the solar. And in that way, we can collect energy, put it into H2, and use that for farming or for other things. It's just a nice thought about entrepreneurship, how you can at least try to implement extra solutions. And as maybe some of you will know that, for example, John Deere, which is a big supplier of tractors, they are actually using the tractor as a sensor for everything, and they are collecting all the data. And John Deere is more becoming a data science company and less a really tractor manufacturing company, which is really a great example of data science and data entrepreneurship. We also can apply that on data-driven diets. We don't have to use the same diet all the time. A nice example is that, for example, the World Food Program, they were in the past using the same diets for helping people in disasters. But then they switched from products to nutritionists, So it can be rice, or it can be wheat, or it can be this or that. And in that way, they save a lot of money by just going back to the basics. That we need something to do on food is clear. In this case, it's the meat consumption all over the place. And as you see, what countries like US, Brazil, Canada, and the UK are using, and how China is growing, that's really, really, it's a bad story. And if you know that beef is about, I thought it was about 7 or 8 times as footprint intensive as, for example, even chicken meat, or even vegetarian, that's even a bigger difference. We can make a huge impact by just stop eating beef. And I think most of you will know Unilever, which is a Dutch-English company. They just acquired what we call the vegetarian butcher. And the butcher is a supplier of vegetarian products. And they call their food meat, because it looks like meat, it tastes like meat, but it isn't meat. It's very sustainable. And it's great that a big company like Unilever is picking up those products and making it into a global product. Another example where data science and data entrepreneurship will be around is in the energy transition. As we are moving away from just a single source like oil or gas into different sources being used at different moments of the day and different moments in the year, this is a huge decision-making problem. Because there can be huge fluctuations in the grid. There is something which is becoming very dynamic if you want to become very sustainable. So this is really a huge data science and also sustainability issue. And we are not prepared for that yet. So in our classes, we have more and more energy people coming in, and they all say the same. We have a huge challenge to move from gas and oil into, let's say, sun and solar and wind, and also H2, which is coming from the sea. But it's a huge challenge to get everything in control, because consumers become producers, and we may have to shift from, for example, sun to wind to maybe, water-driven power plants during the day. We cannot rely on one power plant anymore. Another nice example about food, maybe in the wrong spot in this, but is that in Holland, we have about 30% of food which is being wasted, which is lost in the supply chain or at the end station, because it is not consumed in time. And in Holland, we have now restaurants who get leftover products from retailers at the end of the day, and they use it for dinners in the evening. So instead of spoiling the food products which are not fresh enough anymore at the end of the day, they send it to these restaurants, and they have a dynamic menu based on the leftovers of the restaurants. And it's a very popular chain, especially for people who are really involved in sustainability. Another example of a solution is that people just collect all the facts with a life cycle analysis, which is a big starting point for becoming more sustainable. Also in the housing area, there's a big challenge to save on energy, because that's about 60% of the 25. It's a really huge usage of energy in Holland. Then a nice example, which I also used last year, a nice example of entrepreneurship. That's a solution in which, the sanitation leftovers are being converted into water and fertilizer in one step. They use this system, which is a container solution, on big festivals, so that when people have to go to the toilet, they leave their stuff in there. But in that container, it is being converted into drinking water and into fertilizer. And after the festival, people get fertilizer in a bag, back home, based on what they left on the festival, which I think is really funny and a great example of how things can be done, which seem to be unbelievable. Tomorrow, in a panel, I will discuss this solution with the inventor, Peter Scheer, and he is also using this solution for making houses without sewage. Well, of course, we all know Tesla, which is a great example of data science and data entrepreneurship. In Europe, we have more and more car sharing platforms so that you don't have to buy a car, but you can use it, which again is a great example of data science and data entrepreneurship. Another example is this nice car developed this year at the Eindhoven University. This car is built from waste to totally. So there is nothing new in there. And it looks nice, it drives great, and it is it's great to know it is built from waste. 2 years ago, they came out with another car, which was not built from waste, but it was built from flax, linen, and sugar. From the sugar, they made a kind of a plastic. In that, they added flax to add strength as a composite. And this car is really huge because it's very light. Using only 1 liter of petrol for 300 kilometers. And by building it, that it's very low on energy use to build it. So it's really a great example of what can be done. Another example of what can be done is that in Holland, we are now building bike highways on which you can bike up to 45 kilometers an hour. And just to get people out of the car on an electronic bike, on a speed bike. And even bike sharing is growing a lot, because when we can share bikes, we don't have to buy them. It's especially in Europe, and then you see that North America is very much lagging behind. So there has to be done a lot. That's for the Dutch people in bikes, a big growth area. Just to show you a last example of what data science can do. I've been working in logistics with data science for about 10 years. And by just moving from static routing to dynamic routing, which means that you don't drive the same trips each day, but you move into dynamic routes each day, you can save really more than 40%. Another way of having solutions in the finance industry, there are now platforms where you can just invest in solar panels if you live in the north of Europe, like Scandinavia. You don't have enough sun on your roof, you can buy solar panels everywhere in the world. So there are still many more and new better solutions needed. And the keywords are personalized, dynamic, shared, and data-driven. So now I come to the last part of my presentation, which is about changing behavior, because we can be aware of the problem and we can have sustainable solutions, but are we going to use them? Is there really a motivation to buy an electronic car, to buy solar panels, to really diminish on eating meat and that kind of stuff? So how are we going to move people in the right direction? And this is especially a story for Western Europe and North America, because there the biggest issue is, and there we have to change quite some behaviors. If we want to change behavior, it cannot be done by people at home only, because the consumption of the footprint is about 20% decided on and in the house, which is where we need change in consumption. A big area is in the business, in the value chain, which is about 60%. And there is also a change needed in society with service industries like banks, like governments, like schools, like transportation. That's about 20%. So we as consumers is not the only place to make a change. It's also in the supply chain and in the service industry. So what can be done and what behavior should be pushed? Well, I have to make a split between the easy changes and the difficult changes. For example, in consumption, the easy change is that we just use less, just travel less, eat less beef, have less heating. Very simple measures, the most simple thing you can think of. If that is not possible, we should go for smarter use. for example, by using the energy on our roof, or at least sharing bikes, sharing cars, sharing products. And we have in Holland an initiative, it's called POB, in which you can check if your neighbor has some equipment in the house, which you can borrow from him, so you don't have to buy it. That's just a very simple example of smarter use. Now in the business, the easy way is to change resources. For example, you don't use new resources, but use waste as a source for your products. Another solution is invest and save and make it really into a business. And that's the same for solar panels. Invest in solar panels and make savings so that you earn them back in maybe 8 years. This is something which sounds also valid for consumers. That's true. But many consumers don't have a roof or whatever, so they cannot invest in it. In Holland, we see that now companies are doing it on the roof of distribution centers, on the roofs of government buildings. So, and that has much more effect than just on the roofs of the houses. Change in society, that includes the easy change, I think, that's in laws. It's not really easy because politics is difficult, but concerning about measurements, it's an easy one, because the last one is changing patterns, how we work together as a society, and that's a difficult one. That needs much more time and measurements. So if we translate the top seven measurements in the world, what we can do, and see where they fit and what behavior change is needed, I have made a simple mapping here. And I've made a listing of the different areas where data science can contribute. To use less, it can help to have a cockpit or a recommender system. To use smarter, it's good to have user platforms like PeerB. If you change resources, it's good to have comparisons and also recommender systems, also for business, what you can do to you make better use of resources. So that's all in here. And a lot is on, let's say, making decision support systems and making things more dynamic, personalized. So if we think about decision making, if we want to change behavior, we have in fact to change three things. One is that people get aware of the issue, so that data science is being used to define the right issue, that people see where they can improve. The second is that you can use data science to develop certain alternatives by developing better solutions. And the third step is that we can help people to just make the right choice. And it's a tough thing. Just a few books which are very interesting to learn about how difficult it is to make a change in behavior. One of them is The Power of Habits. In that book, it is really shown that as humans, we really try to stick to our habits. And that's most of it is in our unconscious brain. So there has a lot to be done to make that this unconscious brain. Another thing which is controlling our habits is that we copy behavior a lot from other people. So if we want to change behavior, we have to give the right example. And maybe some of you will know about the book of Kahneman, Thinking Fast and Slow, which says that fast thinking is when we really don't consider it in our mind what we are doing. We are just using habits. And slow thinking is when we really use our brain in an active way. And that's maybe less than 10% of our decisions are made in a slow way with really rational thinking. So the picture I use in our courses for the impact of data science and data entrepreneurship is that data science should help in defining the right issues. That's the awareness part. It should help in developing new solutions, which is the solution part. And it should help in making better decisions, which is the decision part, which, for example, recommender systems. Another way to look at behavior, which will help to make the right measurements, is that behavior is driven by what I call the PLUS model. And that is by goals. What do we want to reach? What are the facts? What do we see around us? Our decision rules and the combination of a goal, a decision rule, and actual facts, that is a decision making. So if you want to change decision making, you can change the facts or the feelings or the solutions. The second thing you can influence are the goals. What are people trying to reach? The third and very important thing you have to change are the decision rules. And then, of course, in the end, if you change all three of these, you will also have a change in behavior. Now, maybe to make a small connection with Kahneman, the fast thinking and the slow thinking is happening in the middle. That's in the decision-making area. So if we want to change the fast and slow thinking, we have to change the facts, the goals, and also the decision rules. And for the fast thinking, we have what we call the hidden decision rules, the habits. And for the slow thinking, we have the rational decision rules. Now, some of you will know about the picture of Davenport, in which he says data science is about descriptive, predictive, and prescriptive analytics. He's right. Those are three well-known ways of applying data science into decision making. But what is not given in this picture is that there is an area where most of the decisions are being made and which are outside the range of data science. And that's the area of the area of limited use of analytics, which is where people use protocols or perception. And that's in fact the fast thinking area. So when we are working as data scientists on changing the world, we should also have a look on the area where we are not having impact yet, which is in protocols and perceptions. And 95% of decisions are being made in that area. Now, if we want to change decisions, we need to motivate people. We can do that in a positive way, focusing on their internal drivers. And that is the most sustainable way. We can, of course, do it also with punishments and changing of laws in a negative way. But that's not a sustainable way of changing behavior. So we really have to challenge the desire of people, the passion of people, the satisfaction, and the self-validation. I always say if you make data science projects, you can think of three reasons to make it happen. One is pain. That means that when people don't do anything, then something goes wrong. And part of the changes can be done in that way. But most of the projects should be driven by pennies or prestige. And pennies is return on investment. And prestige is if people are really proud of making it happen. And I think the public for this event is also greatly about people that say we should be able to make this happen. It is bad for we are too proud, if not just letting it go. So we have to change decision rules to create impact. And we can do that changing decision rules by insights from data. And that actually is data science. This is a complex picture. I won't cover it in detail, but there are many ways to improve the plus symbol with different ways of optimization. So how to change sustainability behavior? There are some measurements included in the reports of the SDG, experimentation and behavior change for realizing the SDG goals. So there is even a toolkit for practitioners given by the SDG organizations. And there they picture about five routes to sustainable behavior, which talks about use social influence, shape good habits, leverage the domino effect, decide whether to talk to the heart or the brain. At the heart, that's the unconscious part, that's the habits part, that's the fast thinking part, or to the brain. That is the slow thinking, that's the rational thinking. And encourage experiences over ownership. So indeed, make sure that people don't have to buy things, but that they just to have access to certain things. I like this listing, but I think it's still very tough for people to understand how you change behavior. And therefore, I prefer to use the PLUS model. Change the facts for people, change the insights and their rules, and then make them aware so they also change their goals. That makes it much more simple to grab. Now, the question, of course, is changing behavior, is that a business? Can you make money from that? Can it be treated as a business? And I'm sure it can, because there are really many companies making money of creating awareness and changing attitudes. If I just mention a company like McKinsey, that's a company who's just involved making business out of creating awareness. And I think that many more of us can do that. It's not easy, but it can be done. And by the way, also education is involved here. So education is also about creating awareness, creating attitudes. So if you don't find a way to make money out of creating awareness, maybe think about getting a job as teacher, or maybe giving courses in the evening, or maybe even give online courses, which is also an option to make money and create awareness. Sustainable solutions. I'm sure there is so much money out there to save on footprint. Just by looking at the fact that the waste industry has been the biggest growth industry in Europe over the last 50 years. And not that many people did notice that, but really it's the huge business. So, and that's also a good signal, you know, because if we are really taking care of waste, we are also improving the world. The last point, can you make money out of sustainable behavior? Yes, I think so. The best way is by introducing platforms in which you can either help people about awareness or in helping making decisions. So here I come back on data entrepreneurship. Data entrepreneurship is helping people to make better decisions, building cockpits, building recommender systems. That should be an important way forward. And next, of course, to things like smart farming and smart energy transitions. That's also where data science is involved. So just to come to a conclusion, when we take care of awareness, sustainable solutions, and sustainable behavior, we can say we get the job done. So as a finishing part, we can do that right away on adults, but we can also apply it on students by having the right courses on what I call data entrepreneurship. In data entrepreneurship, you don't just teach, but you learn people to apply the knowledge in new areas, and you help people to make it into a proof of concept. So it's not just classroom teaching for data entrepreneurship, it's also really actual doing, learning by doing. We do that, for example, at our university with hackathons, for example, for challenging people to find renos in the woods by sensors, but also with smart farming and with smart cities. So treat sustainability as a business and we will move forward. That's our hope. And that's, I think, also proven by the solutions I have shown today. What can you do? Well, you can become a data scientist, become a data entrepreneur. What can companies do? They can hire data scientists and they can train them and help them to create smarter solutions. What can educators do? Well, start a data entrepreneurship program. And we will discuss that tomorrow in the panel around 12:30. 12:30. I will lead a panel on the future of work and the future of education. So data cannot save the world, but data entrepreneurship can. And maybe as a finishing touch, that's what happened to my personal story. I did a few actions over the last 4 years, five years. I decreased my footprint. I went down from 20% to 15% of the benchmark. So that's an increase of 30%. The same for the housing. My mobility changed a lot, including I changed job. And now I go with my train to the university. I don't use, almost don't use the car anymore. I almost don't fly anymore. And I made a further improvement in products. I even buy less products. So I'm now at 65%, but that's not all. I want to move further. My goal is to move down to 25%, the target, which means that I will go down to 2 global hectares, which on average in Europe, it's 8. And what the world can have is 1.8. So if I am on 2 global hectares, I'm still not on the right side of the globe, but I'm getting closer. What did I do for it? I traveled less, I used the train, I bought a hybrid car, I installed solar panels, I invested in solar panels in Africa, and I changed my behavior in some ways. So what do I hope that you remember? I hope you remember after this lecture that data science is about creating insights for decisions making, that data entrepreneurship is about exploiting opportunities to help other people to decide and also to create solutions. And that maybe data can't save the world, but data entrepreneurship can. Thanks, and it's now time for questions.